Another thing you can do is you can use counterexamples, right? Counterexamples are really powerful. If someone says that A implies B, then if you can find a case where A is true but B isn't, then you're undermining the argument. And one of the most beautiful counterexamples that I know of happened at a workshop. I wasn't there, but I've heard about this firsthand from others who were there. That took place at the beautiful Santa Fe Institute here. It's a complex systems institute in the hills above Santa Fe. And there was a workshop where they were talking about physics and complex systems and immune systems. And a theoretical physicist had discovered a little bit about immunology, just enough to be dangerous, and made a mathematical model purporting to prove that many of the features of our immune system are essential for any large, long-lived, multicellular creature. So any kind of creature that's big and lives for a long time, in order to deal with pathogens and parasites, it would have to have features like the recombinational generation of diversity in the immune system and affinity maturation and clonal selection and immune memory and antibody production and so on. A friend of mine was there. He's an actual immunologist, and he was, you know, listening to this whole talk, and he could have chosen to go after any number of parts of the model, because it didn't seem quite right to him. He could have gone after some of the assumptions or some of the way the analysis was done or any of that. But he did something that was much more powerful. When the talk was over, he simply sits back in his chair, raises his hand, and says, "Well, what about trees?" Because the oldest living things on the planet are trees, and they don't have any of these features that this guy had just proved were essential to keep a large organism alive for decades. That's a devastating counter-argument. Analogy. So another thing you can do when trying to help people understand arguments is come up with analogies. For example, this is one of our case studies on the website, which has to do with a Como News story about the Mercer mess, the sort of congestion down going into South Lake Union area along Mercer. And what they said is, well, look, we agreed to try to clean this mess up. We spent $74 million, and now it's only, you know, your travel times are only 2 seconds faster along the Mercer mess. And the implication, you know, 2 seconds cost $74 million. The implication, look at the wasteful government spending, you know, blah, 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 blah. The problem with this argument is that it's really not a very fair way to look at the efficacy of that project. Because if you're looking at transportation in a congested city, if you speed up one route, that's going to draw traffic from all the other routes around it. People are going to shift from the routes they were taking. Things were at equilibrium. They're going to shift back to a new equilibrium. And so the changes that you make to Mercer Street are actually going to affect travel times all over the city, not just along Mercer Street. And we expect things to go back to something like equilibrium in terms of travel times. What you might want to look at instead is the fact that the Mercer Corridor is now handling 30,000 more cars a day than it did before the project without taking any longer. So you could have written a headline that says, you know, travel times is this silly metric. Your headline might have said, well, Seattle Road Improvement Project allows 10 million extra trips per year with no increase in travel times. And that would sort of tell a very different story. Jevin and I were invited to come talk about this story on King 5 News, and we wanted a sort of clever way to illustrate our point about using this misleading metric. And what we came up with, we had about 30 seconds to talk about this part, and what we came up with was to think about another 70 million plus Seattle investment that took place about the same time, and that was the investment in Felix Hernandez. We spent, I think, $78 million to sign Felix in 2009, and you know, it was a total failure because in 2010, Mariners hitting declined. Their team batting average was lower. There were fewer home runs. There were fewer runs scored. Total waste of money, right? And you know, for anyone who knows anything about sports, that's obviously silly because Felix is a pitcher in the American League. He doesn't bat. He has nothing to do with the team's hitting, and it's stupid to use these hitting metrics to evaluate the efficiency of or the success of hiring Felix, right? So that's just using an analogy to kind of show, you know, why one argument is silly.